thank you very much. What I want to talk to you today is, first of all, it is about insurance medicine. And for the last 6 years since I've been taking up this professorship in insurance medicine, I have to explain, first of all, what it is. So I want to do the same exercise. I want to explain you for a moment, short moment, what it is when we talk about insurance medicine and what is the evidence in insurance medicine. I will shortly touch on the reproducibility of judgment on work capacity in a systematic review. This is the part I will squeeze. I just present you the results, so you have to believe me. And we'll present to you the RELY program. It's a case study which we are currently doing. And then link to the theme of the whole session, translating evidence into better health services. Just perhaps as a disclaimer, when I was invited to this presentation more than a year ago, I thought we would have finished our study and I could really talk about lots of implementation of knowledge into health services. Unfortunately, research often takes a little bit longer than anticipated, but I think the approach we had done in our design, it's worthwhile that I nevertheless tell you about it. So, insurance medicine are actually all the medical activities which take place in the context of insurance coverage. So we talk about assessing the health risk. We talk about certifying sick leave, yeah, very common activity of doctors. We talk about evaluating long-term disability, very common procedure, as I will show you in a moment. And the best way to understand the link to evidence-based medicine of all these tasks of insurance medicine is in operationalizing and breaks them down to the underlying activities. And in this context, I will mainly focus on the evaluating on long-term disability, and there we see that doctors have to make a diagnosis, they have to make prognosis, they have to identify interventions that can improve health functioning, they have to look at reliability of expert evaluation. So all activities which are actually very familiar to those people who are involved in evidence-based medicine, these are actually core tasks of, or core activities of doctors. And this is why I think that insurance medicine touches to everybody, every doctor's life or profession. So in this slide, I want to take one slide just to tell you a little bit about a work disability evaluation. Most Western societies provide wage replacement benefits for workers with disabling injuries and disease. And most societies think this is actually the right thing to do. Just to tell you, give you some information on the extent of this issue. Yeah. A recent UK report from the OECD identified or reports that more than 400,000 individuals in the UK apply first time for disability benefits per year. And an additional number, additional numbers to the dimension of the issue is Switzerland, 32,000. Germany, 320,000. USA, the United States, 3.5 million. So you see, this issue really affects a lot of people, yeah? And just what happens with these people who are applying for disability benefit, many, and we don't know how many actually, yeah, but definitely a large proportion have to undergo a medical evaluation in order where doctors determine whether the condition of the claimant, yeah, actually justifies eligibility to the wage replacement. Roughly, and this is a little bit different from country to country, about 50% of the claims are accepted. So for the UK, this means every year more than 2,000 new recipients of disability benefit. So who actually does these evaluations? Who performs medical evaluation for disability benefits? Commonly, and this is a pattern which we observe throughout Europe, I'm not so much familiar with North America, but the vast majority of people are healthcare professionals who still practice as a practitioner seeing patients. So they have this double role. They are an expert, but at the same time, they also see patients. So they have to switch roles. And they do it very often as a sideline. Much less common are that full-time medical experts, so doctors who only do this job, actually make these evaluations. For me, it was very interesting to learn that actually it's sufficient to have a medical degree, yeah, that you can make such determinations and recommendations. So most professional regulatory bodies, yeah, do not require any further qualification than just a medical degree. And I don't know how often you read your newspaper and have an eye on these issues, but there's actually not a lot of satisfaction in what is going on in disability assessment. And periodically, this discontent actually reaches the public and the press, so it's even open discussion about it. When I started my job in Switzerland 6 years ago, it has been a long period of public dispute. Going back to 2004, there was a legal change, which has a change of legislation with access to disability benefits, and which is regularly taken up by lawyers who feel it's a very unfair process, which led to that 3 months after I took up my job, a lawyer brought the Federal Office of Social Insurance from Switzerland to the European Court of Human Rights. So this gives you perhaps an idea about the dimension of the problem. What we did quite early in my job, yeah, was a stakeholder survey. So we wanted to know from all the stakeholders involved in this disability assessment process and the consequences around it, what do they think about the evaluation of work capacity in claimants, and especially with mental disorders, or explicitly with mental disorders, because this is even more difficult to assess. And we asked the lawyers, we asked the expert, we asked the treating psychiatrist, the expert, the judges, and the insurers. And we gave them 4 options between very good and very bad. And what you can see overall, general discontent. So lawyers, vast majority felt it was bad to very bad. Even the experts who were doing the assessments, the majority felt, no, this is not good what we are doing here. The judges, the social judges, so we even asked jurisdiction, yeah, they felt that 50% were unhappy with what was going on, and only the insurer, the majority were actually overall happy, but they had a sufficient large minority which felt this is not a good thing what we are doing and what we are seeing in Switzerland these days. 5 experts, 6 opinion. Does it matter? Well, I think we have a number of issues here. The first issue is, yes, it matters to the patient if it depends on the lawyer with the same health condition. It depends on the medical expert whether his condition gets acknowledged as disabling condition or whether it doesn't get acknowledged. But we have a different challenge. We do not know what it means, work disability. So there is no absolute standard to it. And if you don't have an absolute measure, the second best measure you can get is professional consensus. Yeah? So that the profession can agree at least what it means to have a work disability. Well, if you take professional consensus and put it in a methodological terminology, it means reproducibility. Reproducibility of expert judgment on work disability. This is, in my mind, the current gold standard, yeah, on what we can agree on what disability is, work disability is. We did a systematic review on this, and the criteria for this were that at least 2 or more experts assessing work ability in exactly the same patient, using a global rating of work capacity as the outcome, and this could be just should the person get disability benefit? Yes, no. Should get sick leave? Yes or no. Readiness to return to work, suitability for a function, reduction in working hours. So quite a broad concept of what we meant by a global rating of work capacity. And we were very broad because we had no expectation on what we could actually find. But we said the studies could have a statistical method or just be descriptive, just telling agreement on percentage agreement on something. Our findings, yeah, 13 studies from 6 countries within 23 years. 7 study of these studies, the 13 studies, came from the Netherlands, and this probably for good reason, yeah, because in the Netherlands you have professional insurance physicians with a specialty training, so they train for more than 4 years, and they have a more, possibly more consensus than we have in other countries where it's only done on the sideline. But, and these numbers I find really spectacular, yeah, or worth to remember. So this business where a million of people are affected each year by this kind of assessment, this is an intervention which has been maximum tested by 370 raters with 463 cases. So no medical, absolutely no medical intervention would be sufficiently tested to be applied to patients with such serious consequences. I want to skip this slide because it takes a little bit of time to explain. I just give you the conclusions. Yeah? So we have a very limited body of evidence, but what we found, if we could make sense out of it in any way, because the evidence was also quite low quality, ranging from just short description of cases, yeah, to real assessments in the real insurance medicine setting. If we could find one message to get out of this was that standardizing in eliciting information on work limitations and documenting these findings seems to be a technique to improve reproducibility. And everybody, every educator knows this. Yeah? So if you have a clear scheme on what you rate your patients, your students, yeah, you get more similar results if different raters look at the same claimants. So this is a very basic principle and which is confirmed in this setting. Okay, if we couldn't find, we went out in Basel, we went out to think, okay, this is really a critical issue. It's a burning issue in Switzerland, obviously also in worldwide or in the Western world, we have social security systems. Yeah. Let's develop a program on functional assessment. In our theory, in our perception, how we saw the situation, the main problem was that the doctors who are used and trained into medical assessments suddenly should also come up with a statement on workability. But they have absolutely no training on how do I actually elicit the information from the claimant and how do I apply health limitation, yeah, to what is required in the job. Doctors have no idea about what patients do in their jobs. So this is a program we did. Yeah. This functional assessment was where we focused in our program. We developed a cool toolkit with instruments and training, and then we went over to testing. And my group was determined that we wanted to do this assessment, this testing in the real life assessment. Yeah. So it means in the context of disability assessment for insurance. We planned a reliability study. We wanted to compare the reliability of the functional assessment versus current practice. And we wanted to know whether the whole thing is actually beneficial to the stakeholders who actually have to work with the material they get back from the medical experts. We had a particular interesting opportunity to repeat the study, yeah, in Switzerland in a different language, in a different cultural region in the French-speaking country. And it's quite well known that the German-speaking country are more oriented to the northern regions, to the Germanic languages, while the French-speaking countries are more oriented to French, Italy, and Spain. So different attitudes. And it was also clear from the very beginning, if we don't want to just produce a nice study, which then gets put in the drawers, we designed from the very beginning an implementation program. Because, and now I come back to the main theme, yeah, implementing evidence for better healthcare. Yeah, from the very beginning, we were advised, yeah, to A, make a very clear communication, yeah, because the study is so critical, it's in a highly political, really hot area, yeah, and everybody is nervous, lots of distrust between the different stakeholders, yeah. The National Funding Agency told us, no, from the very beginning, this is a very complex material. Yeah, you need a communication expert who guides you through these difficult situations, yeah, who makes sure that even if you have unpleasant results, yeah, that they can be published ensure from the very beginnings the communication strategy with the insurer, with the government bodies. Yeah. And this office also advised us from the very beginning, yeah, all the stakeholders which are not involved, directly involved in the studies, yeah, they should be put into an observer group, yeah, so that they can have the right, in, on a confidential way, have a right to listen to the, to get all the information in the study, yeah, they see what is going on, and that they have the feelings they can, they are informed, and no hidden agenda is there, they can ask us any questions. So this is to ensure trust, but at the same time, if we really get our the information, the changes we were anticipating, yeah, this was the beginning of the implementation. Yeah. If these groups know that what we have been doing and they learn about it every 6 months about this topic, they had the right to ask us any questions. They would get all the answers we knew, but in a confidential way. It shouldn't go to the press right away. Yeah. But there was this transparency. They could accompany the study through a glass wall, a glass window. Yeah. This actually gave incredible trust. And in particular, there was one lawyer group from Zurich. They were the most critical lawyers, and they made really problems to the insurers. Yeah, and we went there and discussed the study with them. Yeah, we went there and discussed the study with them. Yeah? And after a while, they had agreed to it. So get everybody on board, and most importantly, be really honest, and everybody gets the same information, not more, not less. Yeah, so they could trust each other. This is our toolkit. This is a study where a medical expert makes a trained in functional assessment, assesses a claimant, which is videotaped. And the videotape is given to three other experts who independently, who have also been trained in functional assessment, who independently assess this, assess the interview they had seen, and then everybody has to make a standardized rating about the key functional limitations and come to an overall rating of work capacity. At this point, if you give me two more minutes, because then I present the first results, yeah, and then I stop.
Thank you.
Okay. These are the results of our intervention. We had 19 experts, 30 claimants, 120 ratings. What do you see here? Yeah, you see the results of 30 claimants, claimant 1 to claimant 30, all ratings. Yeah, all ratings. You see here the work capacity from 100% fully able to work to 0 completely disabled to work. And in this column here, yeah, you see the work capacity as a percentage term. Yeah. Referred to the last job that the patient has been working on. And on the second column here, you see the work capacity of claimants to a modified job, modified according to their limitations. So certain things they couldn't do would be alleviated. Just so that you can see it very precisely, these are just these three claimants. And here, the claimant, the experts actually agree on a reasonable level. Most days, this person can work to 100%. There was one expert who said, no, perhaps he can work 60%. He has some limitations for the last and the alternative job. Here's the discrepancy. The variation among the experts is a little bit larger, ranging from 70% to 30%. And here you see the extreme. Yeah? The same patient, depending on the expert you see, the expert says he's 100% able to work or is completely unable to work. And this accounts for the last job as well for modified job according to the limitations. If you see this, we would just say this is a failure of our intervention. Yeah? This is poor. Yeah? And for those who know the technical terms, this is a kappa below, not 0.4, yeah, which is forget it. Yeah, forget it. Yeah. And but another information, and this is always the risk if you perform studies in the real life with political settings where always processes are changed and legislation is changed. What happened here? We trained the doctors. Yeah. Then we came in a political reform about the disability assessment. Yeah. so we had to change recruitment process, we had to change everything. Yeah, and 1 year later, after we had trained the doctors by nine hours. Yeah, 1 year later, where we expected change in behavior. Yeah, 1 year later, we only could start with the ratings. Yeah, so what we, in our interpretation, what we see here, here, is not our, the result of our intervention. What we assume, what we see here, is baseline. Yeah, so this is the normal medical evaluation for work capacity. Yeah, and just to make a longer story short, we decided to repeat the study, improve the training, and give definitely twice as much training. Yeah. And we just finished the recruitment. No, not the recruitment. We just finished the data collection of the 160 ratings, starting with the analysis, and I hope we can show you better results. To summarize, yeah, because of societal controversy on disability assessment and evident lack of evidence to guide changes, we really had to change to make our own production of evidence. Our concept of functional assessment convinced the decision makers, and they allowed us to develop this really comprehensive research program, including implementation. It was actually very, very strongly emphasized, we need the last phase. Our urge to perform the study in real-life disability assessment gave the level, gave the study a high level of trustworthiness, and all, and it gave us a lot of headaches, but we managed. Yeah, and this is also implementation. Implementation and making such study feasible, we managed to get the consent by all stakeholders. If we hadn't gotten the consent by at least one stakeholder, we wouldn't have been able to do the study. What I found very interesting, psychiatrists experienced the training of this assessment as useful for the practice, and they adopted it already beyond the study. So they started to do this kind of evaluation also for regular evaluations. Yeah. And what we can see, the upcoming new guidelines in psychiatric assessment in Switzerland, which will be published after our second study is finished, so we still have space, they wait for the results of the study, they already now will recommend the functional interviewing, which is the first part, and hopefully also the recording and the whole process as an assessment. Okay, implementation has started in the middle of the study. Thank you very much.